The first move is e4, which opens lines for the bishop and the queen. And black's response to this is e5. e5 opens up moves for the bishop and the queen as well. White develops his first piece, knight to f3, which attacks the e5 pawn, covers the d4 square. Pushing the knight towards the centre is best compared to pushing it towards somewhere like h3. Here on f3 it attacks more squares. You'll often hear people talking about developing the knights before the bishops, and this is because they move in smaller steps. They're always limited to a sort of L shape compared to a bishop, which is allowed to move along diagonal and as many squares as it wants, as long as it's on the same colour and it's part of the diagonal. Black's going to respond with knight to c6. This covers the e5 pawn, attacks the d4 square. It's developing one of its pieces and developing out towards the centre as well. It's also developing for the bishop. At this moment, this bishop is caged in, and we're looking at the f8 bishop to move out. Bishop to c4. This move is allowing white to castle early on in the game. This bishop at the moment is attacking the f7 pawn, which is a very common space for the white side to attack, f2 being a common position for black to attack. And this pawn is only at this point guarded by the king, making it a good target. Black's response is bishop c5. Now black is attacking the f2 pawn, the weak pawn for white, as it's only guarded by the king at this point. This is the best position for black in this here for this bishop. White's response is c3. This pawn is going to be defending the d-pawn, as the white side wants to have two pawns in the centre. So c goes forwards first, and then that can be followed by d. Otherwise d would be taken by e5. Usually this c3 square will be reserved for the b1 knight. This position also opens up squares for the queen to go to b3, which would back up the bishop here, attacking the f7 pawn here. Black plays queen to e7. Should white decide to play d4, e5 takes d4, c takes d4, queen takes e4, and check. White at this point decides to castle. Black pushes d6. This allows the bishop to come out, and the d6 pawn is defending the e5 pawn and the bishop. Now white pushes forwards with d4. The idea here is that black will attack the d4 pawn with his e5, and this will provoke an exchange, which will allow white to bring out his rook and pin the queen to the king. It should look something like this. Instead, black pushes his bishop to b6. White decides to set a trap by pushing a pawn to a4. The idea of this is to push the pawn to a5 and attack the b6 bishop. If the bishop does decide to take the a5 pawn, then the d4 pawn will push forwards to attack the knight on d5. Black's response to this is a6. This allows the b6 bishop to retreat. White decides to push to a5, attacking the bishop, and the bishop decides to retreat by a7. white decides to play h3. This is a poor move. It's pushed forwards to stop the possibility that the bishop will come down to g4, pinning the knight to the queen. This position weakens the castled king down here, as you can't push the pawn back. So now there's a way of attacking this pawn, usually through sacrifice of a bishop perhaps. And it'll open up this file here. Possible for the rook to come down, or even attack from that distance. Or lock off this file for the king. Black decides to play knight to f6. This is attacking the e-pawn. Always a good idea to try and develop a piece and attack, or develop and threat, create a threat. D takes e5. Hopefully opening up a line for white to attack. However, the position here is better for black. Open lines are to the advantage of the player whose development is superior. This position, black superior here. So this is not a very good move. Black responds with knight to e5. This puts the knight in a very, very good position. Now the a7 bishop is attacking the f2 pawn, which is a good way of opening up a defense. This could be used as a sacrifice to open up this diagonal here, attacking the king. h3's already opened up a diagonal here. White responds with knight to e5. Putting the f3 knight up here at e5 is a bad idea, as it's better suited down here, protecting the castled king. Black responds with queen to e5. This is a great position for the queen, as it can attack anywhere, pretty much anywhere on the board from this central position. Knight to d2, attempting to save the c4 pawn that the queen's bearing down on. White is hoping that the knight will attack e4. White can take the knight on e4. Queen takes the knight, and then rook decides to pin the black knight to the queen, taking the knight the next move. Black takes the h3 pawn here with the bishop, undeveloped bishop, now a developed bishop, attacking the g2 pawn, starting the attack on this castled king. The g-pawn takes the h3 bishop. This now completely opens up this file to attack the king. Black puts his queen on g3, checking the king. King to h1. This move now allows the f2 pawn to take the queen, as the bishop was attacking that diagonal. Queen to h3 check. King back to g1. Knight to g4. This knight is now guarding this f2 pawn, which would allow the bishop to come down and check the king. Also, the knight is attacking the h2 square, which would then allow him to take the rook. Knight to f3. This knight is guarding the h2 square. The queen at the moment could come down to this h2 square and check the king. However, the knight would take the queen. Queen g3 check, also attacking this last bishop that's protecting the king. King moves to h1. Now this pawn is only protected by the rook on f1. Bishop to f2. This bishop is guarding the g1 flight square for the king should he come back to g1.